Let's pray. Father, we thank you for our worship service. We bless your name because of your word that reaches out to every heart, every time. Thank you for your purpose of bringing us together, the purpose of revealing your mind, your word to everyone. And we pray that your eternal purpose will be fulfilled in every life in Jesus' name. You've sent us to this world to fulfill a particular assignment. And we pray, Lord, that assignment you have given us to do on earth will finish before we come unto glory in Jesus' name. We pray that every step we take and everything we do in this short span of life will bring eternal rewards to every one of us in glory. Thank you, Lord, for the answer. In Jesus' name, we pray. We're considering something peculiar and special this morning. We're looking at Matthew chapter 10. Matthew chapter 10. We're looking at verse 1 and then verses 7 and 8. Matthew chapter 10, verse 1. And when he had called unto him his 12 disciples, he gave them power against unclean spirits, to cast them out, and to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease. I want you to notice in that verse 1, he called his 12 disciples together. These were the disciples that became apostles. Please take note of that. Verse 7, and as ye go, preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out devils. Freely ye have received, freely give. The Lord Jesus Christ, when was on earth, he gave special power, special authority, and special anointing to his apostles, to these 12. And you see that when he gave them the commission to go to the people of Israel and preach the gospel unto them, or the power he gave them, we're told he said, they shall preach the gospel, that's the gospel of salvation. And they shall heal the sick, they shall cast out devils, they should raise the dead, and they shall cleanse the lepers. Later, he called the 70. And he gave the 70 a commission to go and preach the word. We're looking at Luke chapter 10, verse 1. After these things, the Lord appointed other 70 also, which means that these were different from the original set of preachers, evangelists, and proclaimers of the gospel. These 70. And he sent them two and two before his face into every city and place whither he himself would come. Therefore said he unto them, the harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest that he would send forth laborers into his harvest. Look at verse 9. And heal the sick that are therein, and say unto them, the kingdom of God is come nigh unto you. You're going to find out that these 70, their own commission, yes, preach the word, but heal the sick. And you'll find something missing here. The apostles, the 12, had a more elaborate, a more detailed kind of commission. They were to heal the sick, they were to cast out devils, they were to raise the dead, and they were to also cleanse the lepers. In the case of these 70 people, it just says, heal the sick. And he left out the raising of the dead. But looking at Mark, when Jesus rose from the dead, he now gave the commission, not just to the 12, not just the 70, that's talking to the whole church. And the whole church will take the whole gospel and take this whole gospel to the whole world. And they'll preach and proclaim the gospel unto every creature. Here is the commission he gave. Now this is the commission given to everyone of the church. Mark chapter 16, verse 15. And he said unto them, go ye to all the world, and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. And these signs shall follow them that do what? That believe. In my name they shall cast out devils, they shall speak with new tongues, and they shall take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay their hands on the sick, and they shall recover. As you examine the commission given to the apostles, number one, given to the 70, number two, and given to the whole church, number three, you're going to find some kind of omissions and some kind of fullness in the one given to the apostles. That's what I want to talk to you on: apostolic power to raise the dead. Apostolic power to raise the dead. Many times when people look at the scriptures and they just take the promises of the scriptures, they do not really examine what is it the Lord has called us to do, has told us to do. And because they mumble and jump, join everything together, they get into the field and they have some disappointments. And when they have those disappointments, they're wondering why. They say, I'm standing on the promise of God. Thank God you're standing on the promise of God. But you need to understand what promises were given unto the apostles and what promises were given to the whole church. Apostolic power to raise the dead. This promise, this power in particular, was peculiarly and specially given to the apostles. Yes, by looking at John chapter 14, John chapter 14, verse 12, we can say by extension, we can do that too. Yes, we can, by extension, indirectly. But the real promise, in a very peculiar, special way, was given to the apostles. John chapter 14, verse 12. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do, shall he do also. And greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. That's there, but you still need to understand. Are all apostles? The answer is no. Are all prophets? The answer is no. Are all teachers? The answer is no. Are all workers of miracles? The answer is no. And yet it says, he that believes on me, the works I do, he shall do. That means then, as we look at the promise and work at the power, we need to understand what God has given all the believers to do and what God has given the apostles in particular to do. But I want to zero in and focus on the apostles today. Apostolic power to raise the dead. I divide the message to three parts. Number one, a powerful restoration in raising the dead. When the dead is raised, somebody has died. The spirit has gone out of the body. And how to bring that spirit back and make the body, soul, and spirit one again and live on this earth, as a powerful restoration in raising the dead. Number two, a practical responsibility after raising the dead. After raising the dead, there's still something to do. And after healing the sick, there's still something to do. There's a practical responsibility after raising the dead. Number three, a purposeful revelation in restraining death. A purposeful restoration in restraining death. The Lord wants us to understand that more than raising the dead, we can restrain death, prevent death, avoid death. And that revelation is of greater importance to the church and to every family and to everyone, beyond allowing the fellow to die and then running around saying you want to raise him up. There's a revelation the Lord has given to restrain death and prevent death and avoid death. And I pray that you'll spread all your days on earth in Jesus' name. Number one, a powerful restoration in raising the dead. We're looking at Acts of the Apostles chapter 9. Acts chapter 9, I read from verse 40 and verse 41. Acts chapter 9, looking at verse 40. In verse 40, but Peter put them all forth and kneeled down and prayed, and turning him to the body said, Tabitha, arise, Dorcas, arise. And she opened her eyes, and when she saw Peter, she sat up. You'll notice as you look at the cases of raising the dead in the Bible, Old Testament and New Testament. One, they prayed unto the Lord. Two, they spoke directly unto the dead to come back. And you'll see that when you think about Elijah, they didn't have to pray for 10 hours and 24 hours and one whole day and 3 days. They didn't have to rub anything on them. They didn't have to pour anything on them. It was the word of authority, because they were given the power. In the case of Elisha, the same thing you're going to find. Elisha died and Elisha was buried. And when they were going to bury a dead man, then they spied, they saw the people, some kind of people running after them. Very quickly they dropped the dead man. And again, the moment that dead man touched the bone of Elisha, the man rose up, raised to life. So you're going to find it's not a protracted, prolonged, commanding and pulling and dragging and touching and, you know, pouring water, pouring anything. It's the authority. And Peter here said, arise. And we're told that immediately that he said that she arose and sat up. Look at verse 41. And he gave her his hand and lifted her up. And when she had called the saints and the widows, presented her alive. Look at chapter 20. Chapter 20 of Acts. Acts chapter 20. We're reading from verse 9. Acts chapter 20, verse 9. It says in verse 9, and there sat in a window a certain young man named Eutychus, been falling into a deep sleep. And as Peter was long preaching, he sunk down with sleep and fell down from the third loft and was taken up. What's the word? Dead. To start with, I want to ask you, this Eutychus that fell down dead, sitting on a window on the third floor and sitting on that window and was sleeping, the question is, should he have died? The answer is no. Couldn't he have avoided this death? He could have avoided the death. Very simple. Somebody standing nearby, sitting nearby, could say, hey man, you're sleeping, come on down, don't sit on that window. That little thing could have prevented the man dying. And that's why I'm saying that instead of waiting for somebody to die, instead of waiting for somebody to have accident, instead of waiting for somebody to break his bones before we do anything, let's be patient. If they had some ushers there that sat them together, if they had some ushers there that would say, don't sit there, you take us, come down here, sit down here. And by the way, you're sleeping. Don't you know you could fall down there? Nobody did that. Sometimes, some of the things that happen to people, and they will begin to pray and pray, is out of carelessness. I pray you'll not be careless with your life. And then we're told that Paul went down and fell on him, and embracing him, said, trouble not yourselves, for his life is in him. And when he therefore was come up again, and had broken bread and eating, and talked a long while, even till break of day, so he departed, and they brought the young man alive. That's raising the dead, but that's power there, that's authority there. But remember again, it's not any of the people there that went to raise Eutychus up, it was Paul, an apostle. That's what we're talking about, the apostolic power, authority given to them to raise the dead. And they were not a little comforted. We're looking at Mark chapter 5, Mark chapter 5. And I'm reading here from verse 39. Here we find the ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ himself. and he raised the dead, manifested authority, manifested power. Mark chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 39. Mark chapter 5, verse 39. In verse 39, and when he was come in, he says unto them, why make ye this ado and weep? The damsel is not dead, but sleepeth. And they laughed him to scorn. But when he had put them all out, he taketh the father and the mother of the damsel, and them that were was in, and entered in where the damsel was lying. And he took the damsel by the hand, and said unto her, Talita Kumai, which is being interpreted, damsel, I say unto thee, what's the word? Arise, and straightway, immediately. And you can tell that that is power. And this power was not manifested after a kind of, you know, jumping and running up and down and taking the dead up and smashing the floor and this and that. All that will not be necessary when the authority has been given to that apostle. When the authority has been given to the very Son of God, all authority, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. And it says, therefore go, we're told straightway the damsel arose and walked, and she was of the age of 12 years, and they were astonished with great astonishment. Looking at Luke chapter 7. Luke chapter 7. I'm reading here from verse 11. Luke chapter 7, verse 11. As we look at verse 11, it says, and it came to pass the day after that he went into a city called Nain, and many of his disciples went with him, and much people. Now when he came nigh to the gate of the city, behold, there was a dead man carried out, the only son of his mother. And she was a widow, and much people of the city was with her. And when the Lord saw her, he had compassion on her, and said unto her, weep not. And he came and touched the bier, and they that bare him stood still. And he said, young man, I say unto thee, what's the word? Have you noticed that the first time later now, that little girl, arise. Have you noticed over here again? Arise. Have you noticed in the time of Peter with Dorcas? Arise. You see, it's a simple word, just a word, not even up to a sentence, just a word. And then the dead came alive, and he that was dead sat up and began to speak, and he delivered him to his mother. But I'm going to now show you in this same chapter. As I show you in this same chapter, this is the chapter where the Lord Jesus Christ spoke about John after he raised this dead. Before I do that, I want you to write the word powerful. I'm talking about powerful restoration in raising the dead. In the ministry of raising the dead, and almost in any other kind of ministry of the spectacular, something that is peculiar, something that a great exploit, you need these words to take to heart. That's the reason why many people try to do a lot of things and they do not understand how the spirit works. And yes, the dead can be raised today. Yes, the sick can be healed today. Yes, lepers can be cleansed today. And yes, demons can be cast out today. And yes, water can even be turned into wine today. And many, many miracles can happen today. But you need this word powerful. Number one, P, perception in the spirit. Perception in the spirit. How is it that Jesus Christ raised these ones from the dead? Because he perceived in his spirit. What I see the Father do, that is what I do. That's the reason why many people go out and they make a fool of ministry, a fool of themselves. Because they do not have any perception of the spirit. And they just think that every dead person, everywhere, they just go there, lay hands on them, and they'll come up. Not like that. Number all there is obedience to the spirit. When the spirit is saying, this is what you do, obedience to the spirit. And you see, that's the advantage of those apostles and those disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's the reason why you'll find Peter that when Stephen died, and he didn't go there because there was no perception in the spirit. And there was no voice of the spirit he was going to obey. That's why he didn't go there. And then in Acts of the Apostles chapter 12, James died. But there was no perception in the spirit to raise him up. And he must have perceived that Jesus said that the cup I drink, you will drink. And yes, you'll be baptized. Well, the baptism I'll be baptized with. And so when James died, Peter knew that was the right thing to, and that was the right thing to happen to him, because this is what he said. Are you able to drink the cup? Yes, I will. And just said, yes, you will drink the cup. There must be obedience to the spirit. Then W is wisdom in the spirit. Wisdom in the spirit. In fact, please put your finger in Luke chapter 7. I'm still coming back there. But look at Ecclesiastes. Ecclesiastes, I'm reading chapter 9. Ecclesiastes chapter 9. And I'm reading there from verse 16.